Yeah, I can hear.
I need to get off.
He became sin, who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so
good morning. Welcome to Divine Shepherd Lutheran Church. It's a pleasure to be here. I'm Pastor Brent Smith, now going into my fourth week serving here as one of your pastoral team members. It's a joy to be here. We're entering a period these next 5 weeks. Some churches, the calendars call it Lent. It's a Lenten season. It's really a time of focus on repentance and reflection as we focus on the truth. The way, the truth, and the life. These next 5 weeks, that's a verse in John chapter 14, verse 6, where Jesus reminds you, he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So we'll be carrying that theme verse with us for the next 5 weeks up to Palm Sunday, Holy Week, and then Easter Sunday. This week, that aspect of truth that we're looking at is truth versus false testimony. It's so easy to be caught up in little sound bites and snippets and maybe not do our homework and research and make snap judgments and actually not echo and share the truth, but to be led into temptation towards false testimony. When we do that, we repent, We recognize that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and we focus on Him, and He's the one who gives you and me forgiveness and leads us in the way of truth. So let's begin our worship by standing and singing our opening song.
Lord, came down and
of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Will you pray with me, please? Lord God, Heavenly Father, good morning. We thank and praise you that you have rescued us, that you came down into our lives, into this world fallen in sin. Yes, it is true. We dwell on the truth. As hard as it is to hear, we recognize it's true. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Those inside the church, those outside the church, all have sinned. That's the truth. And yet you sent Jesus. You came down. And Lord, as we're living and working in this world, the tempter is prowling about like a lion seeking to devour us, to lead us into temptation. Help us to dwell on the truth. Help us not to commit the sin of false testimony when we describe our neighbor and situations and life in a false way. Help us to testify to the truth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. There's been times in your life when you have made a snap decision and you said something that turned out not to be true. Well, that's false testimony. Or you speak about a neighbor or a political situation or this nation or another nation or a people or language in a way that's not completely accurate. That is false testimony. And during this journey in these next 5 weeks, we are focusing on being a people of truth, the way, the truth, and the life. So if you have fallen short and you've sinned, then confess that to our God by saying, I am a sinner. I am a sinner. One of the joys of being your pastor is getting to announce to you that Jesus has the solution. The situation is covered. He is the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through Him, and yet He opens the door for you to come in. So I announce to you this day what Jesus has commanded me to do, that your sins are forgiven in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated for the hearing of God's Word.
The gospel reading this morning is from Matthew chapter 4, verses 1 through 11. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And after fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. And the tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and set him on the pinnacle of the temple and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone." Jesus said to him, "Again, it is written, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, "All these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." Then Jesus said to him, "Begone, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve." Then the devil left him, and behold, angels came and were ministering to him. This is the word of the Lord.
Let's continue our worship and confessing the words of the Apostles' Creed. We confess, "I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Okay, children, you can gather in the back. There's Miss Trish back there in the back, and you'll head out the door to the left to the children's message, age-appropriate gospel proclamation and singing and fellowshipping together with the children. If it's your first time here and you're a guest or visitor and you have children, you're welcome, mom or dad, to go in and be with your children as well as they learn about the Lord Jesus, that He is the way, the truth, and the life. And they're lining up so obediently. Yay. All right. We'll see you back in worship here in a little while. Let's stand and sing the song of the day.
Savior, I come, quiet my soul. Remember redemption's hill, when your blood was spilled for my ransom. Everything I once held dear, I count it all as loss. Lead me to the cross where your love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay me down. Rid me of myself, I belong to you. Oh, lead me.
Today's message is based on the Holy Gospel from Matthew chapter 4. You may be seated. So, we've journeyed a few weeks together, reflecting on words in the Bible that started with the letter G, to remember that all things are possible with God, that God is the all-powerful one, not the tempter. And so we looked at those, the power of 10G. We're networked in to 10G here at Divine Shepherd Lutheran Church because your God is a powerful God and He gives you all the gifts you need to do His work, to to live the life to the full that He's given you. Last week, we also talked about this all-powerfulness of the God you worship, and that is in Christ. True God, true man, in the one person, Jesus, and His divinity shined through in His transfiguration. And we reflected upon the teaching of Scripture that Jesus was transfigured for your transformation. So what's this week? This week, we're diving in to the topic of truth. And that topic is going to journey with us for the next 5 weeks as we look at different aspects of the truth. So let's read John 14:6 together. Jesus said to him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." What's the opposite of truth? Falsehood, lies. So let's look at truth versus false testimony today. The tempter. What did our text say? The tempter comes to the Son of God. And he says to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." Well, what's the big deal? That's not too difficult for the Almighty God to take stones and turn them into bread. I mean, if He can take water and turn it into wine, if through His voice He can speak into creation all that we see and experience today, what's the big deal about taking a stone and turning it into bread? See, the tempter, he's a crafty liar and father of lies. He comes to Jesus. If you back up in Matthew chapter 4 and the other gospel readings that focus in on this, he comes to Jesus in a moment of humanness. Can we say weakness? Jesus is not sinful, so he's not weak like you and me. He doesn't have impulse control like you and me. He is in his state of humiliation. God incarnate, being humiliated in this sinful world. And as if that wasn't enough, the tempter comes right for him after he had fasted for 40 days and 40 nights. Any of you think you might be hungry after not eating for 40 days and 40 nights? I know, I sure would be. But how does Jesus respond in those moments of his humanness, of his humiliation with the tempter right there in his face? Do it, Jesus. If you're the Son of God, if you're this transfigured God in the flesh, do it. Jesus says, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Whoa, he's teaching us something, isn't he? Our bodies grow. We've got protein drinks. We've got nutritional drinks. We've got sugar-free drinks. We've got all of this stuff to nourish our body. But what nourishes your soul? The living and active Word of God. It's like drinking pure truth. You don't have to wonder, is this right? Is this wrong? It's gulping down. It's flowing through your mind. And that goes and is digested inside of our body. And then our hands do different things. And our feet walk a different way. Being nourished on every word that comes from the mouth of God. How are we doing, sisters and brothers? Are we guzzling down the truth of God on a daily basis, nourishing our soul? Satan doesn't give up easy, does he? So he takes Jesus and he says, "Well, if you're the Son of God, throw yourself down." And then he sort of goes into this twisted way of quoting some scriptures. It says, "He'll command his angels concerning you. On their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against the stone." Did Jesus have the power to do stone into bread? Yes. Does God, the Father that you pray to and who's brought you into this place this morning and protected you and given you guardian angels on these crazy streets out here in the metro area, and yes, he's that powerful. But Jesus saw, he sniffed out what Satan is trying to do with this temptation, and he responds once again with the truth. He says, "It's written, you shall not put your God to the test." Friends, are there things in your lifestyle that is putting God to the test? You already know I like to ride motorcycles. Let's go as fast as they'll go. Yeah, I did it last time. It didn't crash. Not only are consequences to that, but should we put God to the test? Just because he protected us last time? Jesus reminds us. Think about the way we're living. Think about the things we're thinking. Are they putting God to the test? Is there unhealthiness there? This is this period over this next 5 weeks to dive in. What is the truth about our own lifestyle and behaviors? And where is God in Jesus pointing us back and saying, don't put God to the test. Be in the truth. Be in the scripture. So the devil takes him up at this very, very high mountain. And there he was. And he tempts Jesus once again. He shows him the beauty and the glory of all the kingdoms of the world. And boy, that's one thing that is true. God has given us nations and languages and continents and oceans and islands and sunrises and sunsets and sunshine. Boy, do we ever love that this time of year up here kind of in the North Midwest. Vitamin D, soak it up. And yet that wasn't the goal of Satan right here, the devil, as he's tempting Jesus. He says to him, all of these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me. That's ultimately what the tempter, the evil one, wants in your life. He wants you not prostrating yourself down before the altar of the one true God. He wants you taking perfectly God-pleasing things in this world, in this nation, and turning them into an idol. And an idol, you know from catechism class, is when we substitute the things of this world for worshiping God. Are there things that are perfectly God-pleasing that we're starting to misuse, that's starting to take us away from the truth, take us away from where we spend our limited hours in the day, and have become an idol in our life? That's more important than family and people and church. And it's that thing that everything else takes second place. If so, Jesus says, wow, be gone, Satan, for it's written, you shall worship the Lord God, and him only shall you serve. Yesterday was a blast. We'll show some pictures at the end of service. 31 men went to Habitat for Humanity, and we took a house down to the studs. An act of service to help another family in need. It's going to be so much fun to see who moves back into this restored house and the like. Are you being tempted by the evil one to omit acts of service to your neighbor that's in need because you're too busy in your own lifestyle, in your own issues, in your own situation? Really? 24 hours in a day. Jesus is saying, serve God and serve him only. How are we doing that day in and day out? Not just here in the church, but among the nations, among our neighbors, those most in need. Isn't this beautiful? The contrast. You start to taste it, the difference between false testimony and the evils of Satan, the evil one, and the truth, the light of the truth. It just nourishes your body and soul for doing the things that God has called us to do. Satan is a slander. He is a tempter. He is your adversary at every turn. He takes the good things of God and twists them because he wants you to worship him. And for that, we pray, don't lead us into temptation. Protect us from the evil one, the ruler of this unseen demonic world. And who else does he have to go after besides the disciples of Jesus Christ? Be on alert, friends. When I was a little boy out in the Midwest of Nebraska, we drank a little beverage if our tummy hurt, right? Probably has too much sugar in it, really, to be healthy. But it kind of helped my tummy, you know? And we didn't have ice machines that crushed the ice. We just put the cubes of ice into a sack and take the old farm hammer and bang, 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 and there you had crushed ice in a drink. And for some reason, that just was my comfort drink when I was sick. But for some reason, Mom, you know, we didn't have protein drinks that I was aware of, and all these vitamins and all this stuff. It was V8. How many of you used to drink V8 because you thought, there's the vitamins you need? Don't look at the sodium. There's a lot of sodium in there, but, you know, low sugar, it's healthy drink. So what is it in the church that nourishes us on truth? What is it that we as a people of God have in the scriptures to exhort us to exercise healthy habits together as we relate to one another, as we love on one another, so that we are not tempted into bearing false testimony against anyone, even our enemies? To not bear false testimony even against our co-servants here in the church. I'm still in the honeymoon phase of being your pastor because I haven't had an ugly or a hard conversation or anybody come at me yet in a way that misrepresents concerns. So you've been discipled well. That's awesome. You're running full steam ahead. But danger, the testing is coming. Of course, the unseen world and the demonic are after you and me, and so we pray we stick together. I think, what is this E8 stuff? To exercise the eighth commandment, right? Positive humor, not negative humor. I like to take naps. True confession. You can say it. It's true. Oh, I was in the church. Pastor was napping on the job, and people may get concerned or they may smile a little bit. Yes, I have a napping couch in my office. And 4 minutes I had the other day between one meeting and a house blessing. I fell asleep in those 4 minutes and woke up ready to go another 12 hours. It was awesome. But you know what happens when you take a nap on your side and it's loud? You know, when Dad was taking this farmer's nap, we had to, you know, put your one arm over your head. And what does that do? That blocks your ear. So it's quiet. You can't hear the cows. You can't hear the cars honking. But when you do that for 20 plus years on your side, it puts a crease in your forehead right here. And I went and checked it out. And they said, sorry, Pastor, not even Botox can take care of that. It's called being over 50, I guess. Now, you can either, you know, play around and humorously make fun of the crease in my forehead. That may borderline negative humor, okay? You might actually start to hurt my feelings. I sure hope nobody does that to you. Positive humor. March 31st, our very own Chris. Where is Chris? Chris, now that's a funny wave you got back there. This is Chris. He is March 31st, part of our positive humor team. And yes, guess what? I found out what Chris was saying about me. See, the kids nicknamed me PBS for Pastor Brent Smith. I was like, well, yeah, that's the initials of my name. People can remember that because I'm a walking, talking, public broadcasting system pointing you to the beautiful Savior. But no, not our comedian in the house. He's like, no, Brent's married to Jenny. Pastor Brent's married to Jenny. We're going to call him PB&J. See, now that's positive humor. Who doesn't like peanut butter and jelly sandwiches? I mean, this is a staple. You know, call us PB&J. Jenny and I love it. Let's have some fun. Let's talk to one another, but be careful. We got issues to discuss here as brothers and sisters in Christ, right? When we say, oh, that's a complete disaster. The church is falling apart. We've got all kinds of problems. I hate to even point it out, but friends, yes, there is a crack, goes from right here all the way across. See, I told you, Pastor, the church is going to pieces. It's a complete disaster. We're on national news. Be careful. It's just a tiny crack. It's not falling down. The steel behind that is strong as ever, right? Oh, but you always do this, or you never clean up after cooking bacon and eggs. The grease is all over the place. Never? You only have to clean up once for that to be a false statement. And yes, gentlemen, if you're cooking bacon and eggs and not, you know, cleaning up, well, let's clean up after ourselves, right? Be careful. There's danger words out there as we're interacting as siblings, sisters, and brothers, and loving on one another, friends. God has given us a reason to exercise the eighth commandment. That is, that we shall not bear false testimony against our neighbor. And what does that mean? Well, that means that we should fear and love God so we do not tell lies, but to explain everything in the kindest way. You see, when the scriptures use those extreme terms like all are sinners and to explain everything in the kindest way, that's the truth. That's how we're to be as a people of God, a different culture, a community that even in the most difficult discussions, people pick up on the love we have for one another. So if I push pause, or if you feel like, oh, hold on, Pastor, in that meeting we have or something, and if you feel like I too, as a poor, miserable sinner, am going down a road and I'm not describing something in a biblical way, in a truthful way, say, whoa, whoa, E8, Pastor, E8, exercise the eighth commandment. E8, Pastor, put the best construction on everything. Please do it. Confront me. That's what we all need, to encourage one another. So what do you think? Should we try to apply this text today? Could the evil one, the tempter, lead us into temptation as we're praying about something? I got a book. It's about this thick. It was a Genesis study you did. And you stepped out on faith. This was right before the pandemic. It's an amazing piece of research and work. And what it did is it said, should this congregation step out on faith and expand Little Lamb Preschool and Childcare? And you did. And even during the pandemic, it stayed open. And it's exploded. It's maxed out. Over 100, almost 120 kids day in and day out here all week. And now what are we hearing? Is this phase two? To add another room or two of the infant rooms and another 16 kids to that work. And then also some saying, Pastor, we have an idea. I think it's a great idea too. What if God would provide 20 kindergartners that graduate from Little Lambs and go to what could be called Divine Shepherd Academy? And we get them one more year to infuse Jesus into their kindergarten years. And they're learning to read in that stage, right? That's when you get to learn. You get all these books and you love to read. And then what if we could find space in this beautiful campus to add first grade and second grade? And then merge them into the other opportunities in a wonderful way, but give them that many more years of Jesus, the truth, and true curriculum, and true teaching. It's a discussion.
I've heard that Lutheran schools, they only cost the congregation money and they're never self-sustaining, and
that may have some truth in some places, but is that really true? There's 3,000 schools like we have, Lutheran schools throughout this nation. Are all of them in the red? Are all of them almost ready to go under? I don't think so. God is providing, but let's count the cost. Let's do the study. Let's work together. Pastor, what are you talking about, going off the main campus? Everybody should come to main campus. Well, I would love it if everybody would come. 800,000 in the metro, could we fill them all? You know that if we had this synced into the other spaces in this building, that in this level there can be 1,250 between the chapel and the gym and here, and we could hold 1,250, and in the lower level about another 1,200. Whoa. But some of them are classrooms. Can you imagine if God sent us, like he did that day in Pentecost, thousands of people saved? What would we do? Yeah, that would shake up our world. Already we have a couple opportunities in the South and West to try to reach people who, I guess they won't drive 3 miles. I don't know. But they're not coming. They're down there. What did Jesus do? Jesus gathered his disciples. He had a main campus. His main campus in his day was called the temple. It was the third temple. They had built it, torn down, destroyed, rebuilt it. It was in the third temple period. He could have said, y'all come into the temple if you want to hear me preach. What did Jesus do? He was in the temple preaching, but he was in homes. He was sharing the word. The church in homes. And then he went to the synagogues, kind of like your post-exile community center. He was there, and he was also on mountains. Was that a tradition of the church of his time, that you should be preaching on a mountaintop? Mm-mm. But he did it. One of the most well-known sermons he preached, the Sermon on the Mount. And then he jumps into the boat and the like. Wherever God is calling us to preach the word, that's where we should be. It's not either or so often. It can be both and integrating all these ministries together for his glory. How about trying to apply this to number three? Oh, anniversaries. These are usually the ones that really start, right? Oh, we should have a big blowout celebration. We're burning the mortgage. You know, the church has been paid off now, and just a little tiny mortgage on the school side. But the church, how big should the bonfire be? Oh, we can't have a bonfire. Well, we got to have a bonfire. This is a big milestone. We're turning 50. Awesome. How are we going to discuss and reason together? Should we do 50 healthy meals? Should we do, you know, what should we do? We even set up an email for you, 50years@dsomaha.org. If you have ideas, the planning team, Jessica, are you here? Anybody else? Gina, are you? You might be another. There's Gina, Jessica. Their ideas, get them flowing. Let's do something fun. How about 50 cross-training workouts? How would that go? Let's do planks for 50 minutes. No planks for 50 minutes. 50 seconds. 50-second planks. What could you think of, kids? Wouldn't it be fun to think of some ideas to celebrate? Maybe since some of our paint is as old as the church, maybe it's as simple as getting out the paintbrushes together as a body of Christ. And giving a little facelift to some of the campus around here. Let's be creative. Let's have fun. Let's exercise the eighth commandment. And as we discuss it, let's speak in terms of everything in the kindest way. So in closing, friends, be careful. Peter, who confessed Christ, it was hard for him to hear the truth of God. And when Jesus was talking about how he must, as a son of God, must suffer and die, and he was going into his passion, Peter said, whoa, 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 that's not the kingdom building I had in mind. And he pulled Jesus aside and rebuked him. No way, Jesus, are you going to die. And Jesus said, get behind me, Satan. When we are led into falsehood, and when we are giving false testimony, we are behaving like the evil one, the adversary. We are called by the truth to set our minds on the things of God day in and day out. Let's journey together and do that. And please remember, as we struggle to find the truth sometimes with all the sound bites around, that Jesus is the way and the truth. Jesus went through that temptation that we saw in the wilderness in our text today. He also went through another time because the cup he drank was not V8 juice. As nutrition as that will, and they probably had tomatoes in his day and they crushed it up. Maybe they had a tomato drink. I haven't read that in the church history. But he drank the cup of suffering. He died for your sins. He was praying in the garden, take this cup from me, because he knew that all sin of past, present, and future, all evil, all false testimony, all of that was put on him, and he nailed it to a cross and said, it's finished, judgment over. And because of that, you can celebrate. You have life eternal. So as we close, let's just think about E8. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. And please read the explanation to the eighth commandment as a people of God. Together, we should fear and love God so that we do not tell lies, but explain everything in the kindest way. In Jesus' name, give us the power to do so. Amen. We continue our worship with the offering.
the dearest and best, for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. So despised by the world, there's a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross. Was on that old cross Jesus suffered and died to pardon and sanctify me.
Pray the prayers of the church. Lord God, Heavenly Father, the old rugged cross, we thank and praise you, Jesus, that you stood firm in the midst of temptation from the evil one, the father of lies, there in the wilderness in one of those most challenging moments where your body, your human body, had gone without food for 40 days and nights. Thank you, Jesus. You're faithful. Thank you, Jesus, for being the way and the truth and the life. Thank you, Jesus, that you teach us how to respond like you responded to the evil one. You responded with the living and active Word of God. Help us in the midst of transitioning from different places and people and contexts to be focused not on false testimony, but to explain everything in the kindest way, to seek the truth in all situations, in our relationships, in our family of God, in the church, as we think about what the future holds for us. Be with us, Lord. Lead us not into temptation as we think about the will for our families and friends, for the communities and the ends of the earth, for Christians around the world who are persecuted as Satan leashes out with violence against them and rages in this time period from when you, Jesus, rose from the dead and are coming back again. Protect them end the hostilities in Ukraine, we pray, and other places throughout the world, and give support, Lord. May those who have been impacted by the earthquake in Turkey and Syria not lose hope in you, even in the midst of evil and loss of life. Lord, for those struggling with sickness, may they not lose hope. May the tempter not cause them to despair. We pray for the strength and healing of Bill, Greg, Al, Kathy, Lois, Steve, Sherwin, Paula, Bill, Shirley, Doris, Andy, Daryl, Tom, Bill, Deb, Gary, and Angie. Lord, heal them according to your will. And just as the angels tended to Jesus, Heavenly Father, after his temptation, so tend to all those who are in need. We thank and praise you that you give us strength, Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, you've made us your dwelling place as our bodies are your temple. And so, Holy Spirit, continue to bring and strengthen strong marriages. We thank you for the 41st wedding anniversary of Ken and Kathy Weber. We thank you for the 49th wedding anniversary of Steve and Gayla Jip. Continue, Lord, to strengthen the marriage between one man and one woman for your glory and your worship alone and in service, in procreation, and also in service to the community through families. Lord, for those who are single, we know that the tempter can come, and yet this is also a vocation, a life that you bless. So many of the disciples were single and enabled them to go on missionary journeys and dedicate themselves for the proclamation of the gospel, to call people to repentance and to forgiveness of sins. And so those may be struggling with the temptations of singlehood. Lord, give them peace. Give them protection from the evil one. And Lord, as we think and listen, ideas we know are not the enemy, especially if they're ideas that are in line with your word. So the idea of adding more rooms to the child care, the idea of possibly serving these children past pre-K and into kindergarten, first and second grade, hear our prayer, Lord. Guide us in accordance with your word and help us to think through in this 50th anniversary year your will and how you'd have your word in this main campus and your word saturate throughout the entire Omaha metro and to the ends of the earth. Lord Jesus, Heavenly Father and Holy Spirit, we pray the prayer that you have taught us. Together, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated for a couple brief announcements. Yes, comedy night. Can I get a drum roll there? A lick on the guitar? Yeah, awesome. Chris is going to be with the comedian from Nashville, Johnny W. It's at Divine Shepherd. Take note, moms and dads, there's free childcare for ages 2 to 12. You can sign up on our website. Yeah, to cover the cost of bringing this jokester, this funny comedian all the way here to Divine Shepherd. It does cost a little bit, so we're asking for $25 a person, but it'll be a wonderful evening, March 31st, 7 p.m., and that is no joke. Pun intended. Midweek classes and meals are back. $5.15. The midweek meals, that's $5 for an adult. Kids eat free. Where can you beat that around the metro? You can't. It's great home cooking right from Jen Perkins and midweek meal. $5.15. Come in. Rolling schedule. By $6.15, the midweek classes start. That's age-appropriate learning based on formal curriculum. It's awesome to learn about Jesus that way. And then the midweek Lenten services are at 7:30 p.m. Please come. We're hosting another choir. There was a choir, chamber choir here this morning at the 8 o'clock. Sent them on their way back to Lincoln at Concordia in Seward. The Concordia University St. Paul Concert Band will be here March 5th, 7 p.m. Check that out. Lastly, there is still time to sign up for the Bridges one-day training on March 4th. That's this coming Saturday. It's at Thanksgiving Church. It's how you can learn about Muslims that are in our midst and find creative ways to share with them that Jesus is more than a prophet. He's Savior and Lord. He is God, our heavenly Messiah. Do we have a picture of Pastor Jim? Boy, this was a blast. 31 guys. There he is, Pastor Jim Rasmussen, up in the top left corner. If you didn't catch this event where we tore a house in a morning down to the studs and then filled our tummies with a mountain of meatloaf. That's the picture in the middle. A huge mountain that's meatloaf and potatoes and gravy. It was awesome. That's just one event of many women's events and men's events that are happening here at Divine Shepherd Lutheran Church. So please check out the Heartbeat, which is our newsletter, or go on our website, or just take my card and my mobile phone and my email and shoot me an email with ways in which you would like to serve our Lord. All right, let's close our worship by standing and singing our closing song.